This video is brought to you by Brilliant. Being cheaper, more energy dense, and longer lasting than lithium ion technology, lithium sulfur batteries may be the holy grail of power storage. Besides fueling electric vehicles adoption, they could turbocharge the integration of renewables into our energy grid. However, a technical fault has been holding back their economic feasibility until now. An accidental yet major discovery may have finally unlocked their full potential. Could this lithium sulfur discovery make it the future of battery storage? Let's see if we can come to a decision on this. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. Energy storage is the key to the future of renewables. It's why I'm so fascinated by different battery technologies and talk about them so much on the channel. The king of the hill right now is lithium ion, which we've all used and know really well. We've got them in our pockets and smartphones, on our wrists with smartwatches, and now in our cars. However, there's another kid in town that's been getting some attention: lithium sulfur batteries. Over the last few years, they've been touted as a strong candidate for making a new energy storage era, but they haven't made it into the market yet. Now, a group of chemical engineers from Drexel University have found a way to enable their real-world application. I'll get to that in a minute, but first let's look at why lithium sulfur batteries could be a revolutionary upgrade for lithium ion technology. The cathode of lithium ion batteries is mostly made up of critical minerals such as nickel and cobalt. Yet our hunger for EVs is driving up the demand for these two raw materials. According to a recent study, Europe may find nickel and cobalt shortages as early as 2030. The report also predicts that the EU will need 100% more nickel and 330% more cobalt to become climate neutral by 2050. While our planet's stock may be enough to meet these targets, cobalt and nickel sourcing is not keeping up with demand. And that's partially because of slow progress in developing new mines. For example, in the US, it takes up to 10 years to secure a mine permit. On top of that, we're lacking processing facilities to turn minerals into battery-friendly components. Coupled with an insane demand, the slow-moving supply chain leads to shortages of battery ingredients and ultimately skyrocketing prices. Besides these problems, there are sustainability issues behind their production. 70% of global cobalt comes from the Democratic Republic of Congo, which has some serious issues with forced and child labor. As for nickel processing, we currently rely on wasteful and carbon-intensive methods. In particular, Indonesian nickel is the least environmentally friendly, and there are concerns that they're dumping mining tailings into the sea, which pollutes the waters as well. In contrast, being the 10th most abundant element on Earth, sulfur is easier to find than cobalt and nickel. Plus, it can be obtained as a byproduct of various industrial processes, such as petroleum refining. In other words, it's a cheaper and greener feedstock. That's why introducing sulfur in the cathode formulation would relieve the pressure on the EV supply chain and could reduce cars' costs. Perhaps one of the chief benefits would be turning a byproduct into a useful product. Aside from saving on raw materials, using lithium sulfur batteries could achieve up to 8 times greater energy density than lithium ion designs. Now, what does that mean in practice? For instance, if you were to swap your EV lithium ion battery with a lithium sulfur one, you could drive your car roughly 8 times longer without needing to recharge. Or you could keep your existing range with a much smaller, lighter, and cheaper battery pack. However, lithium sulfur batteries are not flawless. They have a big one. Their major problem is the so-called polysulfides shuttle. Basically, when a battery is discharging, an oily carbonate-based electrolyte carries lithium ions from the anode to the cathode. Here, the lithium ions react with the sulfur to form lithium sulfide. It's a bit more complicated than that, but the key point is that the reaction with the carbonate electrolyte creates an irreversible product. The trouble is that some of these compounds get lost into the electrolyte solution, and during the charging stage, are shuttled from the cathode towards the anode. Once they get there, polysulfides may convert into a solid form and cover the electrode with an insulating layer. Besides blocking the transport of lithium ions during the next discharge cycle, the irreversible buildup of that barrier bites into the cathode. You may see why these mechanisms reduce both the battery capacity and charging and discharging efficiencies. Crazy as it sounds, a study found that the aggressive reaction between polysulfides and the carbonate electrolyte solution may shut down lithium sulfur batteries after the first cycle. In the best case scenario, you can recharge these devices no more than 100 times. And that's nothing when you compare that to a commercial lithium ion battery that can last 2000 cycles or more. That's where the Drexel researchers' fortuitous lightbulb moment comes in. It's not the first time scientists have found something by chance. Think of Viagra, for instance. It was being tested as a heart medication when a certain, let's call it side effect, caught their attention. Well, this lithium sulfur discovery isn't X-rated, but could lead it to a new path for commercializing lithium sulfur batteries. With the aim of preventing polysulfides formation, the Drexel team tried to isolate sulfur from the carbonate solution by locking it inside the micropores of a carbon nanofiber matrix. As described in their paper published last February, they attempted that by using a vapor deposition technique. yet something didn't quite work out as expected. Instead of being trapped within the carbon framework, sulfur particles were just laying on top of its surface. And that's when something even more unexpected happened. Despite sulfur particles and carbonate solution coming into contact, researchers couldn't see any polysulfides. Puzzled by their experiment outcome, they repeated this test over 100 times. I reached out to Dr. Vipha Kalra, the paper's lead author, to find out more about their lucky discovery.
The first time we got this data, we thought it was an artifact. And that's one of the reasons we ran almost 100 cells. But of course, in addition to the repeatability aspect, we did a lot of other electrochemical tests to make sure that we are truly seeing a direct conversion from sulfur to Li2S and we are eliminating the polysulfides. It took us months to convince ourselves that this is truly a redox of sulfur going to Li2S, and that's what's giving us this very high energy storage.
After further investigation, scientists figured out that when changing from a gas to solid, like during the vapor deposition coatings, sulfur turned into one of the most elusive forms, the so-called monoclinic gamma phase sulfur. Now, that doesn't react with the carbonate-based electrolyte, which explains why polysulfides were nowhere to be seen. What nobody can still explain is how they created that phase, and it's very rare and supposed to be unstable below 95 degrees Celsius or 203 degrees Fahrenheit. And despite the mystery, after a year of testing, Dr. Kalra and her coworkers proved their sulfur cathode stabilization over charge-discharge cycles, which is about 2 times the duration of a lithium-ion battery. And to add to that, their initial battery capacity is about 3 times that boasted by the lithium-ion competition. Although this is not the first time that scientists have designed a high-performance lithium-sulfur battery, the Drexel Group's magic trick is bringing the device closer to mass production. So why is that? Well, their unique solution eliminates the polysulfide creation completely. While other researchers have tried to minimize the effects by replacing the benchmark carbonate electrolyte with an ether-based solution, which doesn't react in the same way. And while this does address some of the polysulfide issues, it doesn't stop the formation and also introduces a safety concern. These alternative electrolytes contain compounds with boiling points as low as 42 degrees Celsius, or about 108 degrees Fahrenheit. As the battery warms up during its operation, this will likely evaporate and the pressure buildup could cause battery damage. It's a big engineering issue. And aside from greater safety, Dr. Kalra brought up another crucial advantage in using a carbonate electrolyte.
Carbonate electrolyte is the electrolyte of choice for the lithium-ion industry for the last 30 years. The industry has developed a lot of know-how on these carbonate electrolytes, and that includes a wide range of additives that perform a wide range of functions, such as flame retardancy, SEI formation for safety aspects, and so on.
Which makes sense. It's much easier to scale something up when using well-established industrial practices. As a bonus of their fortunate sulfur-based cathode stabilization, researchers said they could also try their luck using sodium instead of lithium for making the anode. And that would be a big improvement. To begin with, sodium is around 1,400 times more abundant than lithium in the Earth's crust. Extracting and purifying lithium is more tricky and expensive than sodium as well. Just like cobalt and nickel, conventional batteries Keystone has been experiencing supply crunches and rising prices. Since the beginning of 2022, the price of lithium has doubled. In China, which is by far the world's largest EV battery manufacturer, lithium carbonate, the most common battery-grade lithium form on the market, saw a 7-fold price increase over the last year. So you probably can see why using sodium would make the battery way more affordable. Now, lithium sourcing also poses some sustainability risks. Last January, green activists forced the Serbian government to scrap the Rio Tinto license for developing what would have been Europe's biggest lithium mine by output. Protesters argued that the lithium mine would have polluted local water and land. Besides contaminating it, lithium extraction consumes a lot of water. To be more specific, around 500,000 gallons per ton of lithium. And there are new techniques that are helping with that, which I've talked about in previous videos. And I'll include links to those in the description. Anyway, the sodium incorporation is not on top of Drexel's agenda, as the team first has to resolve the scientific and technological challenges associated with the current setup.
So scientifically, we want to understand the chemistry more, and we want to more clearly answer the questions of how we are stabilizing the gamma sulfur at room temperature when it's known to not stabilize under 95 degrees Celsius. We also want to understand how this particular crystal structure is enabling a complete change of redox phenomena in the lithium sulfur battery. So the technological steps would be to scale up the production of these gamma sulfurs and build prototype level battery.
This sounds like a lot of work. So how long will it take?
We've been talking to a lot of industry folks to try and get an understanding of of the steps beyond where we are right now. And our understanding for generally for such a technology would be more in the range of 5 to 6 years.
I don't know about you, but that's actually sooner than I was expecting. Also, assuming this technology eventually pans out, it won't just improve EV range. Dr. Kalra highlighted some of the possible use cases.
So I feel this could fit into many applications, for example, something like drones, right? Where weight is an issue, at the same time, you do need longer run times. Aerospace industry could be another direction. So there's a lot of different applications.
But Dr. Kalra's research group is not the only one advancing lithium sulfur battery technology. There's a company who's managed to accomplish a version of the carbon nanofiber matrix approach, somewhat similar to what the Drexel's team was working on originally. Lightning claims to have caged the sulfur into 3D graphene structures, which mitigates the polysulfide shuttle effect. Now, additionally, their architecture features a coating on top of their lithium anode to inhibit the growth of dendrites, which is another major cause for the failure of lithium sulfur batteries. From their press release about their light cell prototype battery, it could run for over 1,400 cycles under the Department of Defense test protocols. While their battery lifespan is not as long and robust as that measured by Drexel in the lab with their discovery, Lightning seems to be one step ahead on the way to the market. With a throughput of about 250,000 cells per year, Lightning's pilot plant is supposed to go online some point in 2022. Drexel's unexpected yet radical achievement may be finally pulling the sought-after lithium sulfur battery within commercial reach. With lower cost, higher power density, and greater durability, this technology could change the way we think about energy storage for good. Having said that, scientists will still need to prove their optimized device outside of the lab. So our cars, smartphones, and drones will have to wait a little bit longer before being supercharged to the next level. I'm pretty excited about what this could mean for the future of EVs and renewable energy. If you'd like to learn more about the science behind lithium-ion batteries and chemical reactions, I'd strongly recommend checking out Brilliant. They have fantastic interactive courses like the electricity and magnetism course that has helped me to get a better understanding of how current works. But if you really want to get your head wrapped around some of what we covered in the lithium sulfur batteries and the chemistry behind it, the chemical reaction course has your back with topics like ions and charge, as well as how chemical reactions are dominated by the movement of electrons within and between substances. I had a good time going through both of these and really enjoy being able to learn at my own pace. All the concepts are taught through fun and interactive challenges to help you understand the why of something, not just the how. It helps you to develop your intuition, which is my favorite part about Brilliant. Over the years, I've found that's how I learn best. Go to brilliant.org/undecided to sign up for free. And also, the first 200 people will get 20% off their annual premium membership. Thanks to Brilliant and to all of you for supporting the channel. So if you come to a decision on this, do you think that lithium sulfur batteries will become one of the go-to energy storage technologies? Jump in the comments and let me know. If you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones I've linked to right here. And thanks to all of my patrons for your continued support, and welcome to some new supporters. Gonna butcher some names. Eric Arso, Robert Derby, Chris Lambert, and producers Jamie Higgs and Foxman150. And thanks to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.